Just begin with Marc-Olivier. It's your turn.
Thank you, Professor Rozek, and good morning, everybody. I thank this far for this invitation to talk about post-operative atrial fibrillation. I have no conflict of interest to declare. And so, for the definition of atrial fibrillation, this is a very important question. So atrial fibrillation is documented by a surface ECG short heart rhythm with no discernible repeat P waves and irregular RR interval. The minimum duration of an ECG tracing of atrial fibrillation required to establish the diagnosis of clinical atrial fibrillation is at least 30 seconds and enter 12 lead ECG. The context of postoperative atrial fibrillation do not change this definition. Arterial fibrillation is the most common sustained cardiac arrhythmia in adults in the world. The lifetime atrial fibrillation risk estimate of 1 in 3 individuals of European ancestry at index age of 55 years. Increasing age is a prominent atrial fibrillation risk factor, but increasing burden of other comorbidities, including hypertension, diabetes, heart failure, coronary artery disease, chronic kidney disease, obesity, and obstructive sleep apnea is also important and in progression. So atrial fibrillation is very common in the population, and atrial fibrillation is also very common following cardiac surgery, non-cardiac thoracic surgery, and following vascular or large colorectal surgery. But why postoperative atrial fibrillation is so frequent? This figure depicts the time course of substrate development and surgery-related factors in the occurrence of atrial fibrillation. Time course of proarrhythmic mechanism is depicted in the two hypothetical patients undergoing cardiac surgery, both chronic as well as acute factors related to the operation on day zero are shown. When the intensity of proarrhythmic factor reaches a certain threshold, atrial fibrillation will occur. Patient one, as example, has no relevant cardiovascular history, only hypertension. Patient two already developed hypertension at a younger age, followed by diabetes, mitral regurgitation, and COPD at an older age, respectively. Both patients have no history of atrial fibrillation and undergo on-pump coronary artery bypass grafting at the same age. However, only patient two has developed an atrial fibrillation substrate by the time of operation due to the above-mentioned cardiovascular disease. Chronic factors are summarized in this slide. Finally, stop smoking and alcohol consumption could be suggested some weeks before surgery, with no other factors could be controlled. While chronic factors of atrial fibrillation are frequent, they are in majority uncontrolled. In contrast with surgery and acute factors like both systemic inflammation and oxidative stress, who could be decreased using mini-invasive and fast surgeries. In contrast with surgery and sympathetic activation could be decreased evading hypovolemia, anemia, pain, hypoxemia, and hypothermia. So the beta blocker could be interesting to decrease this sympathetic activation. Some studies have shown that its use could decrease the incidence of postoperative atrial fibrillation, while the PISE study have described an increase in mortality using metoprolol in perioperative setting, probably because of an increase in stroke. Perioperative beta blocker or amiodarone is recommended for the prevention of postoperative atrial fibrillation in cardiac surgery. This is grade 1A. Beta blocker should not be used routinely for the prevention of postoperative atrial fibrillation in patients having non-cardiac surgery, because their use could increase mortality in sitting. This is a POISE study. Statins, magnesium, sotalol, colchicine, and atrial pacing corticosteroid are not recommended because data are not robust. So despite prevention, postoperative atrial fibrillation could occur, so we should discuss this treatment. The first step for the physicians is to perform simultaneously arterial blood gazes to avoid or treat anemia, hypoxemia, hypokalemia, to practice pleural and cardiac echography to avoid or treat hypovolemia, pericardiac effusion, or pneumothorax, and to assess the clinical tolerance of the atrial fibrillation. First case, hemodynamic instability could occur, and so you should use these items to define this hemodynamic instability, such as syncope, acute pulmonary edema, myocardial ischemia, symptomatic hypotension, cardiogenic shock. In ICU and patients having with severely impaired left ventricular systolic function, atrial fibrillation is often precipitated by increased sympathetic tone. Inotrope, vasopressor, and rhythm control is often unsuccessful. It is important to identify and correct precipitating factors and secondary cause and optimize background treatment. The electrical cardioversion should be performed quickly. Anterior-posterior electrode positions restore sinus rhythm more effectively and should be preferred. A synchronized direct current electrical cardioversion should be performed. You can show on this example the hemodynamic efficacy of external electrical cardioversion in regard to the index cardiac and blood pressure measurements. In the second case, if the hemodynamic is stable for your patients. So there is no symptomatic patients and the rate control should be considered using beta blocker agents. However, if the patient is symptomatic, amiodarone should be preferred. So the rate control is the first line for these last guidelines. You should use institutional protocol to safely use beta blockers. The protocol of my hospital is SURE-HEAD, using landiolol in the FACT trial that we are conducting. If patient is symptomatic, you can use amiodarone as recommended by the USA. But side effects of amiodarone should be known by physicians. Thyroid abnormalities, photosensibility, peripheral neuropathy, lung fibrosis, liver damage, cardiac depression, or corneal microdeposits. Why prefer rate control more than rhythm control in this strategy? Because the urgency is to decrease VO2 for the myocardial energy balance. Secondly, atrial fibrillation could be resolved spontaneously in more than half of cases. Third, amiodarone could have undesirable effects and could conduce to symptomatic bradycardia when beta blocker were simultaneously used. Atrial fibrillation could conduce to spontaneous contrast in the left atrium with high risk of thrombus, especially in the left auricle, as shown in the figure on the right. Then after, the thrombus could be responsible to a stroke. You can show on this video a thrombus ball which is ready to embolize. As postoperative atrial fibrillation increase the risk of stroke, anticoagulation should be performed for each postoperative atrial fibrillation lasting at least 48 hours for 4 to 6 weeks and must be reassessed by a cardiologist. Indeed, oral anticoagulation was associated with a significant lower risk of thromboembolic events in both postoperative atrial fibrillation and non-surgery atrial fibrillation compared with non-oral anticoagulation. Some studies are trying to precise the optimal long-term oral anticoagulation use among patients developing postoperative atrial fibrillation. So in conclusion, postoperative atrial fibrillation frequently occurs. The physiopathology should be well understood by physicians. The first step could be conducted simultaneously using arterial blood gases, echography, and to assess clinical tolerance. Electrical cardioversion or beta blocker should be considered as a first-line therapy, and postoperative atrial fibrillation could conduct to cardiology follow-up, especially for the anticoagulation. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Marc-Olivier. I have a question from the audience about the use of cordaron or bisoprolol in case of atrial fibrillation after surgery. What is your opinion on more to be largest, why do you prefer landiolized beta blocker than bisoprolol and all the other beta blockers that could be give orally? Could you explain, please, Marc-Olivier?
There is several reasons. At first, as I showed to you, postoperative atrial fibrillation could be spontaneously resolved before the first day in more than 50% of case. So this is a question. Why introduce amiodarone? We should be prescribed for 4 or 6 weeks following the introduction of this treatment. This is the first question. Secondly, the urgency is to decrease the heart rate, and so it's probably more effective to use beta blocker than amiodarone for this goal. Some studies have shown that beta blocker could be more effective than amiodarone, especially in ASEAN studies, which could use landiolol from 20 years ago. And finally, a lot of patients have a beta blocker chronic prescription. And so it's probably a rebound of lack of perioperative beta blocker. And so it could be interesting to prescribe more aggressively the beta blocker in the perioperative setting.
Okay, it's very clear. So I think we don't have time. Maybe it's a challenge for you, Marc-Olivier. Are there specific recommendation or anticoagulation for postoperative atrial fibrillation? You've got less than 1 minute to answer.
Okay, it's a great challenge. In fact, the evidence of oral anticoagulation effects in patients with postoperative atrial fibrillation is not very robust. That's true that oral anticoagulation use during follow-up was associated with a significantly lower risk of thromboembolic events in both postoperative atrial fibrillation and non-surgery atrial fibrillation compared with non-oral anticoagulation. However, there is perhaps a difference between cardiac and non-cardiac surgery, but again, no robust data are available as yet. So clinicians should follow guidelines using oral anticoagulation for all postoperative atrial fibrillation for more than 48 hours with a reappraisal with a cardiologist 4 to 6 weeks after.
Okay.
I hope to be clear.
Yes, it's clear. And just an answer by yes or no. Digoxin can be used, ask the audience. No way.
No way.
Okay, thank you.